I trust that everyone has filled their stomachs and feeling satisfied. No sleeping, though. No sleeping. We have a wonderful program in store. So right now, I'd like to call up our Mistress of Ceremonies, Sister Shunice Criswell. Please give her a hand.
Hello, everybody. Did you enjoy the food or what? I'm gonna get up here and try to run this program, and I got the itis. Goodness gracious. Let's give Miss Regina a hand clap for this beautiful brunch. Because it's every year, and it always turns out wonderful. This is actually my second time being here. 2 years ago, I danced here. I don't know if you guys remember me, but I had an awesome time. And I'm happy to be back as your mistress of ceremony. So you gotta deal with me for the next couple of hours. Is that all right? Amen, amen, amen. At this time, we're going to have a prayer by Mother Ruthie Flanagan, and then we're going to have a welcome by Sister Salma Haji.
We give honor to God, and we thank God for being here today. Thanks, Sister Goodwin and Brother Goodwin, for allowing us to be here today. As we pray now, Heavenly Father, we just come to you thanking you and giving you the glory, Lord. Father, we thank you for enabling us to rise this morning. You gave us a good night's rest, hopefully. And we just give you the thanks and praises. Lord, we ask that you would cover your blessing over everyone here today. In the name of Jesus. Father, we pray that you would give strength to Regina and her family. Bless all of her relatives for it. All of her friends and loved ones. And Father, we just give you the thanks and praises. We know that it is nothing that we've done, but it's all your goodness and your love that you have given to us. And Lord, we pray that you would let us extend your love through us in the name of Jesus. We pray that you would take care and watch over everyone as they leave this place and as they go about their journeys every day. In the name of Jesus, we give you the thanks and praises, Lord. Amen.
Amen. Just a quick history about the gathering of the Hens. It first started 16 years ago today at Sister Regina's home. What started out as a weekend event of women of all ages, generations coming together, talking, motivating, uplifting, crying, just consoling one another. It grew to be a beautiful event. As you can see, this is my second year here at His Lordship's. So I'm very grateful, and I know we are all very grateful to Sister Regina and her husband, Aaron Goodwin. So just a little brief history of what a mom is. What a mom is, she's a friend, she's a sister, she's your first teacher. A mother is someone that you consult in. For example, Sister Regina to me is my second mother. I wish my mother could be here for this event, but I look to Sister Regina and I look to all the other older members of our church as mothers as well. So I just hope and pray that you all learn something from this event today, as I know we all will. So sit back and enjoy the show. Yeah.
Wasn't that a beautiful welcome?
Yeah.
If you didn't feel welcome before, I'm pretty sure you're welcome now. Let's give her another hand clap. That was awesome. Good history to know. Now listen, I'm so full, I don't know what to do. So if y'all see a button open, just yell out buttons or close it. Because I am full. I can't hold it in no more. Anyway, that food is good, huh? Glory to God. God is good. You know what we need. All right, check it. Listen, mother. If you pray like that ever again, you're going to see me running outside through those windows. Praise God. Look at mother. Hey, that was beautiful. It's something when the mothers can pray. Amen? I remember back when I was a little girl, the mothers would just tarry at the altar. And I mean, that's when people had power, right? We saw instant deliverance and healing. And I just thank God for mothers. And I thank God for being able to sit under wisdom. Let's give it up for the mothers. Don't they look beautiful? Amen. You all look so beautiful in your red. Is that for the blood of Jesus? Or? All right. Amen. 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 Let's give it up for Jesus then. Come on, y'all can do better than that. Hallelujah. If it wasn't for him, and if it had not been for the Lord on our side, right? Where will we be? Glory to God. Glory to God. So I'm looking for an awesome time for the rest of the program. Anybody looking for an awesome time?
Yeah.
Amen. 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 Listen, we're going to have a song selection by Sister Zipporah Robinson. Deliverance begin to take place. Anybody contain myself, but I love Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. All right, that's what happens when you give a preacher a mic. She'll run or he'll run on with it. Glory to God. All right, let's move on. We're moving on. We're moving on. Jesus, hallelujah. We're moving on. All right, listen, listen, listen. We have a poem by Sister Kim Tompkins. Are you here? Hey, man, let's give it up for Sister Kim. I pray for you as you follow that baby over there. She didn't call on Jesus. I don't know what you're going to do, but we're praying for you.
Good afternoon, Saints. Good afternoon, everybody. I don't know if I can follow that, but I will give you my best. For those that do not know me, my name is Sister Kim Tompkins, and I will be reading to you this poem entitled Through the Storms. Very good poem, personal testimony on my end. I don't know if I'll touch or any of you can relate, but I'm gonna give you my best. So here we go. I did not know his love before, the way I know it now. I could not see my need for him. My pride would not allow. I had it all without a care, the self-sufficient lie. My path was smooth, my sea was still, not a cloud was in my sky. I thought I knew his love for me. I thought I'd seen his grace. I thought I did not need to grow. I thought I'd found my place. But then the way grew rough and dark. The storm clouds quickly rolled. The waves began to rock my ship. My anchor would not hold. The ship that I built myself was made of foolish pride. It fell apart and left me bare with nowhere else to hide. I had no strength or face to face the trials that lay ahead. And so I simply prayed to him and bowed my weary head. His loving arms enveloped me, and then he helped me stand. He said, you still must face this storm, but I will hold your hand. So through the dark and lonely night, he guided me through pain. I could not see the light or day or when the storm might wane. Yet through the aches and endless tears, my faith began to grow. I could not see it all at the time, but my light began to show. I saw God's love in brand new light, his grace and mercy too. For only when self was gone could Jesus's love shine through. It was not easy in the storm. I sometimes wondered why. At times I thought, I can't go on. I'd hurt and doubt and cry. But Jesus never left my side. He guided me each day. Through pain and strife, through fire and flood, he helped me all the way. And now I see as never before how great his love can be. How in my weakness, he is strong. How Jesus cares for me. He worked it out all for my good. Although the way was rough, he only sent what I can bear. And then he cried, enough. He raised his hands and he said, be still. He made the storm clouds cease. He opened up the gates and flooded me with peace. I saw his face, now clearer still. I felt his presence strong. I found anew his faithfulness. He never did me wrong. Now I know more storms will come, but only for my good. For pain and tears have helped me grow as not else ever could. I still have so much more to learn as Jesus works in me. If in the storm I love him more, then that's where I want to be.
Hey man, you can do better than that. That was beautiful. You keep writing. That is so awesome. You have such an amazing gift. I think, did I mention that I had a piece of cake on top of that food? And I think it was that last piece of cake that made this inside of my stomach poke out. And so now my shirt is uneven and now my buttons are crying right now. So remember to yell out button if you see a button open, okay? Ooh, okay, 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 okay. Look, that was beautiful. Let's give it up for her one more time. Thank you so much for sharing your gift with us. Awesome, awesome, awesome. I think a button trying to come open. Hold on. All right. All right, listen. We're getting ready to call up a team called Unity through Praise Dance. Amen. Come on and bless us. I'm excited. They are awesome. Y'all can do better than that. They are awesome, awesome, awesome. Amen. Give it up for Unity.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord,
everybody. Come on, clap your hands if you love Jesus. We bring you greetings from Cosmopolitan Baptist Church, where our pastor is Pastor Larry Ashley. We are Unity, the youth and young adult dance ministry at our church. So this song that we're dancing to is called Free. How many of you want to be free in Jesus?
Amen.
Free from sickness, depression, whatever you're going through. How many of you just want to be free in Jesus?
Amen.
So pray with us as we minister to you, because we're ministering to ourselves as well.
Redeemer has saved me from sin. My soul is awakened at Him. Free from what held me. My soul is alive.
captives free. Glory to God. Be free. That is awesome. Awesome. Be free from bondage. She said, be free from what mama and daddy did to you. Be free from broken relationships. Good God Almighty. Anybody been in a broken relationship before? I don't wish that on my worst enemy. Be free today. Glory to God. That message was be free. I'm here to encourage you in the second their motion. Be free. Amen. Be free. Be free. Somebody say be free.
Be free.
Somebody say be free.
Be free.
Yell it like you really want somebody to free. Be free.
Be free.
Glory to God. Give God a hand clap of praise. Thank you, Unity. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Most of the stuff she does by hand, but she was very strong about it.
They Bible bags. Okay. Look through here and see if there's another one.
Let me get my.
Okay.
Hi. Let me get my brother.
Okay.
You're going to act like you're on the phone, okay? Ring, ring, ring.
Hello.
Hey, y'all.
Hey.
Listen. Somebody dropped their earring by the bathroom and somebody found it. So I feel like somebody's gonna feel like air going through their earlobe or something because they're missing an earring. So if that's you, say holla.
Holla.
All right. Okay, listen, we have a skit right now by Sister Bessie Smith and Sister Deborah Pickett. Come on down. Now, this depends, however, if you do good, we're gonna call up, who is the people, Tyler Perry, and tell them to take you on the road. So you better do your good work, okay?
First, giving honor to God, I'd like to tell you the name of our skit is Unforgiveness.
Hey, haven't seen you in a while.
Hey.
Especially at church.
I know, girl. I know. I haven't been to church in about 3 years. I mean, 3 whole years.
That long?
Yes. I'm a CME member now.
CME member?
Yes.
What's that?
That stands for Christmas, Mother's Day, and Easter. I only go 3 times a year, and that's enough.
Girl, that's terrible. What happened?
Girl, I'm still mad at Pastor Wade in the water. He really did me wrong. I should have had him arrested or should have sued him.
Girl, I'm still at Old Saints. Pastor Moses Wade in the water, he's a good preacher and teacher. We're about to build a new church.
I don't know what to say. He's just a fake to me. I'm sorry. He told me that if I prayed every day, that my prayers would be answered.
Sometimes our prayers are answered, but it's just God telling us no.
But I was so faithful and I was committed.
But you should not have that unforgiving spirit. It's been 3 years. Girl, get over it.
I know. But and you know what? I still get angry every time I go past the church or when I hear his name and voice over the radio. Girl, and now still, after 3 years, it's hard for me to get to sleep at night. That man really hurt my feelings.
Girl, you know you can't be like that. You have to forgive him, or our Heavenly Father won't forgive you.
I'm not mad at God. I'm mad at his messenger.
Can I share some scriptures with you?
Oh, what time is it? Girl, I gotta go. You know, I got a doctor's appointment later. Girl, Pastor Moses this way, and the water gave me an ulcer, girl. And I'm still stressed out.
Did you ever try to talk to him or sit down and discuss what's wrong? He may not even know what he did to hurt you.
No, but I bet he missed my ties.
Your ties? Those are God's ties.
Girl, I gotta go. Shoot, I gotta go. But you know what, really, girlfriend, I'm so glad that I did run into you today.
I'm glad you did too.
You know, I've been going to church all my life since I was in Sunday school. And I know I haven't been in 3 years, and you know, it's all over me, you know. But deep down inside, I know that I can't let man keep me away from God.
That's right. I'm gonna pray for you, okay? And give me a call sometime.
Okay, and please pray for me, sister.
All right. Unforgiveness in our hearts can kill us a little every day. Amen. It can cause us to have a hardened heart. It can elevate our blood pressure. Amen. And it can make us a bitter person. Yes. And also it can prevent God from blessing us.
Well, just one more thing. If you or a loved one have suffered from hurt, betrayal, or unforgiveness, get help now. Find it in your hearts to forgive. If you are currently experiencing severe pain, for compensation, please call 1-800-JESUS-SAVES. Life is too short, so get it right today. Jesus is the only way. Thank you. That was beautiful. Give it up. We all need to forgive something or somebody, right? Without forgiveness, we cannot move on. We hinder our own selves. You need to forgive. You can't forget. Well, you can if you want to, but I won't. But you gotta forgive. You gotta forgive. Let's give it up one more time. We gotta call Tyler Perry. It's time to take y'all on the road. That was beautiful. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. Listen, we have another praise dance by Sister Sakari. Did I say that right?
Yeah.
Sister, where you at, girl? Sister girl. Amen. Look at her. She's so beautiful. Oh, bless us, all right? We're going to call Tyler, too, if you do good.
Feels so good to make it this far. And I didn't think I could take it so long. There were days I wanted to quit. And I said, surely this is it. But I held on. And I've watched as so-called friends turned and walked away. And it hurt so much I didn't have words to say. But even when my day turns to night and nothing seems just right, Lord, I thank you for my life, for my life. Lord, I thank you for every victory in you I've seen, and all the moments I know, Lord, it was you who kept me. So I thank you take my family from there to here. And when times were a little rough, And the moments I thought I'd fail, I was reminded of your nails. So I held on. And if I never live to see another day, there's nothing I would change or take away. I've had so many ups that they far outweigh my downs. Lord, I thank you for my life, for my life. Lord, I thank you for every victory in you I've seen.
Just a few seconds to look back over your life and just think about where God has really brought you from. Think about how he has came through for you time and time and time again. Oh my God, the song says, I may not be all that I want to be yet. Oh, but thank God it's that yet, hallelujah. Because guess what, I still got time to be all that I can be in God. But if you look back over your life and really truly see where God has brought you from, you can't help but give God praise. Glory to God. Somebody said, when you get to thinking, you get to thanking. I dare 10 of you in here just real quick to stand up on your feet and just get that one thing that God has done for you and begin to cry out, thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you for delivering me. Thank you for salvation. I dare somebody to scream out, hallelujah. Come on, scream out, thank you, Lord. Come on, lose yourself. Just give it to him. He deserves it. He deserves all. Jesus. Hallelujah. Ooh, we thank him today. Aren't we having a good time? Hallelujah. Thank you, Sister Sakari. Where did she go? Such an anointed gift in the body of Christ. Lord Jesus. I pray that God just opens up major doors for her in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Okay, Ayala. Holla. Where you at, girl? Oh, God bless you. I'm so sorry. Give it up for Mother. Come on. Down, Mother. Bless us. I thought it was somebody in Florida got here.
Praise the Lord, everybody. God is good to us. Giving honor to God and to all of the mothers and to Sister Regina. I bring you greetings from Greater St. John Baptist Church. Reverend Peyton is the pastor. And you know, sometimes we have to encourage ourselves, mothers. And my first selection I'll do, I'm encouraged.
Encourage yourself.
Sister Regina asked me to do a couple of numbers, three numbers. And this next one is, I know it, but God is so good. Yeah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Yeah. Did you just feel like clapping your hands? Come on and clap. Mm-hmm.
Gracefully. We gotta add that Lee on there, I'm so sorry. Graceful Lee. And then after the praise dance, we're gonna have our speaker of the hour, Sister Mae Henderson. I know she's gonna give us a powerful word. I cannot wait, I'm excited. And then after that, we're gonna have the lovely closing remarks by Sister Regina Goodwin, amen?
Amen.
Thank you so much for allowing me to be your program mover. I had a ball. Let's enjoy the rest of the service.
All praises and honors go to God.
Yeah.
I am truly, truly blessed to be here today. I stand before you. I'm a member of the Cosmopolitan Missionary Baptist Church in Oakland, where the Reverend Mary Ashley is my pastor.
Amen.
I am a member of the Graceful Praise Dance Ministry at Cosmopolitan. We are the senior dance group at my church. However, the rest of my group had to work. They were all called to work, so I was left to dance alone. I am also the director of Charlie's Angels Praise Dance Ministry with my granddaughter.
Amen.
So she said, Gigi, I refuse to let you dance alone today. I'm going to dance with you. So you will truly be blessed by Charlie's Angels as we minister to you. Isaiah 53 and 5 says, by his stripes we are healed. We are doing a song for you today that says we're going to claim our healing. So in this song, you're going to see us reach out, and we're going to grab it, and we're going to grab that healing. So if any of you are among us today that need to be healed, reach out and grab your healing, because our healing comes from Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen.
Starting today, today, I claim my healing. Starting today, today, I claim my healing. And it's mine, it's mine, it's mine.
Hallelujah, somebody.
Hallelujah.
All praises, glory, and honor to God on today. Let's just give God a good hand praise. Let us just say thank you, Jesus. Sister Criswell and all the program participants and all that has happened before us on today. I'm just mighty glad to be here. I bring you greetings from the greater St. Paul Baptist Church in Oakland, where Bishop Joseph E. Simmons is my pastor. And I don't want to talk too much and give too much testimony, but I have to clear up a few things. And also where I'm under wonderful watch care right now with Bishop Silas Johnson and Dr. Jennifer Johnson in North Little Rock, Arkansas.
All right.
I have been away for some months, so the first thing I have to clear up is I am not back, people of God. I'm not back. Everybody says, oh, Mother May is back. No, I'm not back. I'm just passing through. The other thing that I have to clear up, I owned this wonderful business in downtown Oakland called the Hat Library. Many of you know about it. So the Hat Library is closed. That's why I came back, to close the Hat Library. But that's just temporary, too. I'll be back greater.
Yeah.
All glory and honor and reverence to God. I'm glad to be with you. And I have another assignment today. I have to do as I'm assigned. I have to be mobile. I told myself, no, that's got to come forward. I need something to put my book on, but that's still got to come forward because I have to move. I want to honor a couple of people on today, and I need your help doing that. I want to honor the Goodwins, Sister Regina and Brother Henderson. Matthew chapter 6, over about the 14th and 15th verses, it says, "For if ye forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you." I think I need to say that one more time. "For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you." And it goes on to say, "But if ye forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive you your trespasses." Let us pray. Our Father, our God, how we thank you for another opportunity just to stand before your people, oh God, just to say a word on your behalf. God, I didn't come to hoop and holler and scream and stomp. Came to minister today. So I just ask that you would minister unto your people, God, in and through me. We thank you. We love you, we bless you, we lift you, we praise you. We'll give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. Have your way now, in Jesus' blessed name. And the people of God said, amen and amen. Amen. I go back to the skit, and I'm like, Lord, what is this, a setup? What's going on here? There's somebody today in this room that's yet broken, that's yet hurt, that has yet become that CME member over something some man, some person, some human did or said. But I've got new good news for you today. Some real good news. You are forgiven. I don't care Did you hear what I said? You are forgiven. I don't care if you feel like it, you're forgiven. I don't care if nobody told you that you were forgiven, you're forgiven. I don't care. I don't care. You are forgiven. Whether you like it or not, whether you feel like it or not, you are forgiven. If you are a real Christian, a real Christian, now I ain't talking about church folks now. That's a whole nother message about church folks. I could talk about them for a while. But I'm talking about a real Christian, a born again believer who's placed their trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. You are forgiven. Now allow me to tell you why I'm so excited about that, about the fact that you've been forgiven. First is the question of who needs forgiveness. Anybody know the answer? Everybody. We all need forgiveness. Me, you, mama, grandma, pastor, Pope Francis, we all need forgiveness. All have sinned. Bible don't say y'all have sinned. It said all have sinned. Each and every one of us have come short of the glory of God. And we all need forgiveness. Now I need to talk about the difference between the fact of sin and the acts of sin. We commit many acts, and the reason we commit the acts is because of the fact. And the fact of sin means that I was born a sinner. I was conceived in iniquity, and since my mother conceived, I was born a sinner. It's like a little baby rattlesnake. Does he have to do anything to be a rattlesnake or become poisonous? Just be born. So in order to become a sinner, we didn't do nothing. It wasn't about what we did. It was about how we were born. Mm-hmm. See, Adam and Eve started the whole mess when they messed up and Daddy Adam got me in the sea. Oh, but I got some good news. Oh, Jesus Christ got me out. Yes. He came to redeem me and set me free. Yes. So now that we have talked about the fact of sin, I don't know about you, but I'm glad I've been forgiven for that fact. And that it still remains forgiveness for the acts. 1 John 1:9 said, if we confess our sin, not only will he forgive our sin, but he is faithful and just to cleanse us. Does somebody need cleansing today? Oh, come on now. You quit playing with me. I know I'm not the only one whose mind needs cleansing. I know I'm not the only one that had some thoughts. I know I'm not the only one who did some deeds. We all need it. I don't care how they like to say it, baptized, blood washed, and Holy Ghost still, yeah, you still sin. Yes, you do. You know, it's in our nature. And we need forgiveness. So I want you to know that forgiveness is available. Now that we've established that we all need it, let's talk about what it is. Forgiveness is the act of excusing or pardoning another in spite of their shortcomings, errors, or wrongdoing. As a theological term, forgiveness refers to God's pardon for the sins of mankind. Christ prayed to God to forgive when he was on the cross, and he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. It was not a plea that willful sin be excused, but rather they didn't have any real understanding of what they were doing. They thought they knew, but they really didn't know. They thought they were doing the right thing. Let me see if I can explain that to you. This is one of those God-ordained times when the wrong thing was the right thing. Let me tell you what I'm talking about. In other words, what they did was the right thing in the sense of it had to be done. He had to die. He had to go to Calvary. But it was the wrong thing because they were doing it for the wrong reasons. They weren't doing it because God said they thought they were doing it. Oh, I got an analogy for you. That person that hurt you so bad, that thing that happened to you, oh, it was the wrong thing, but it was for the right reason. Yeah. Then you come out better. Don't you feel better? Don't you look stronger? Don't you draw in your faith increase? Can you draw a little closer unto the Lord because it happened to you? Oh, I thank you, Lord. Oh, I'm like David. I even thank you for my trials, because if I didn't have them, I wouldn't know you like I know you now. Oh, God, I wouldn't know how to trust you in the midnight. Oh, if I hadn't had a little rain, I wouldn't be able to appreciate the sunshine. Think about all that they did to you. Think about all that hurt that you experienced. Oh, and it seemed like the wrong thing, but it had the right reasons. For the Bible says all things still do work together for the good of those who love the Lord and are the called according to his purposes. Hallelujah. To accept God's forgiveness includes the responsibility now to forgive others. But there's one person you need to forgive before you even go on to others. You need to forgive yourself. Yeah. Some of us messed up. Look, I have done some stuff so stupid that if I told you what it was, I hope you wouldn't believe me anyway. We all come short. So first of all, forgive yourself. Oh, what, that bag's too heavy? What that man say? You don't need to check it at the curb. Don't be carrying around all that excess baggage. God don't care. Look, he said he'll throw it in the sea of forgiveness. Now it's man that gets out there with a pole trying to dig it up. So you just ignore him and go on because God says he has forgotten. Let me also clear up this myth about forgive and forget. That's not in the Bible, honey. The Bible don't say that, okay? What's supposed to happen is that you're supposed to be so completely free of that, you're supposed to let it go so that when they walk in the room, you don't feel a thing. Hey, just keep on stepping. Keep on walking. Let it go. Get over it. Get on with your life. Don't be like the CME member and stay out of church for 3 years. Right. Well, guess what? That preacher was a man before he became a preacher. Right. You know that? So talk to the Lord about it. And the Lord didn't send us to straighten out the preacher and straighten out the church. I don't know about you, but he's not my job. You know, I might be an elder in the church, but it ain't my job to run it. It ain't my job to straighten out stuff. It's my job to take it to the Lord in prayer. So first of all, forgive yourself. And then learn how to forgive others. Amen. Forgive everybody that has, is, and will try to ruin your life. Because trust me, there's a whole lot of people out there that don't like what they see. Right. Now, I don't care what you've done or what you've... There's somebody that don't like you. They don't even know you, but they still don't like you. Amen. Accept it and get over it. Yep. And move on with your life. Yes, even that one, that special one. Forgive everyone, everything, every hurt, every pain. Forgive. Amen. You are forgiven to forgive. Yes. You've been forgiven to forgive. Forgiving others is the key to living in the liberty, the freeing forgiveness of Christ. The judgments of God are based on his perfect knowledge, not just on the actions, but rather on the motive. He knows what you did and why you did it. Nobody, you cannot hide from God. He's always with us, ever present with us. So get over it, whatever you did, forgive yourself, and then whatever others have done, forgive them. Forgiveness does not mean that there's an absence of justice, but rather justice and mercy acting in perfect harmony. If it wasn't for justice, whoo, hallelujah, wouldn't be no need for mercy. So God is a just God. Yeah, Christ had to go to Calvary because God can't be anybody but God. And he said sin is wrong and said it had to be punished. Thank God for Jesus, somebody, that went to Calvary and paid it all for me. I'm mighty glad about that. Adam and Eve started out. They committed the first sin and passed the sin nature on to my ancestors and me. He forgave them and gave them another chance. I'm not going to be long before you today. The day is long spent. I just want somebody to know that you've been forgiven to forgive. I just want somebody to understand deep down in your soul that you are really forgiven. You don't believe me? I got some examples. Moses was a murderer with a speech impediment. God forgave him and used him to lead God's people out of Egypt. Yes, he did. David was an adulterer, a liar, and a murderer. He forgave him and called him a man after his own heart. After he'd been forgiven. You've been forgiven. Rahab was a prostitute, if you want to go there. And he forgave her and let her be in the family lineage. Matthew was a hated tax collector and a thief. And he forgave him and made him a disciple. Paul was a persecutor, a serial killer of sorts, killing Christians. But he forgave him and made him a powerful preacher. Oh, hallelujah. 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 chance. Because I would have been out of chances a long time ago. He's a God. He's a God of another chance. And whatever you've done, whatever happened to you, you've got another chance. And don't forget about me, Miss Goody Two Shoes I was. Church girl, born in the South, raised in the church, didn't smoke, dip, drink, or chew, and didn't hang out with those who do. The worst kind of self-righteous mess you ever wanted to see, because I didn't know Jesus. Well, I was in the church all right. But one day somebody told me that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. One day somebody told me Jesus went to Calvary to pay for a wretch like me. And I was glad about it. Hallelujah. I said, now either something wrong with this man or I'm a sinner. Even though I've been in the church all my life. So that doesn't have much to do with anything. But if you love Christ, if you turn your life over, you're forgiven. I'm forgiven. You're forgiven. Even on a bad day, you forgive. Jesus was having a bad day one time, one Friday. It was a bad day, one Friday. They crucified him and hung him on an old rugged cross, stretched him out. Oh, but a bad day became a good day. And God became Good Friday. Hallelujah, because he died for me. Hallelujah, because he died for you. Hallelujah, because he set us free. I told you I'm on assignment today. And as I close, I want you to think about something. I thank God I'm forgiven. I want to read, turn to Ephesians 4, 31 and 32. Put out those smartphones and Bibles, and if you don't have the Bible on that, shame on you. If you say you're a Christian, and you ain't got no free Bible. Now what's up with that? Ephesians 4, yeah, free app. Free app. You ain't got no excuse no more when you're on the bar and at the bar station and at the bus and in the doctor's office. You don't have no excuse. I want to read from my old raggedy New Living Translation from Ephesians 4, verses 31 and 32. And I'm reading from the New Living, but I want you to follow along with me. And then I'm going to ask you to pray and to do something with me. Ephesians 4, verses 31, 32 in the Living Translation. Say, stop being mean. Stop being mean. Bad-tempered and angry. Quarreling with harsh words and dislike of others should have no place in your lives. Instead, be kind to each other, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, forgiving one another, forgiving one another, forgiving one another, just as God has forgiven you because you belong to Christ. I want you to be silent for a moment. I want you to be in prayer just for a moment. And I would like if you have a pencil and you turn over and do it on the back of your program, on a notepad or somewhere. But if you don't, at least do it in your heart. Think of three people you need to forgive. Yourself and two others. Think of three people you need to forgive. Now review in your mind why you need to forgive them. Go with it. Close your eyes, if that helps. And actually picture yourself first, and then the two others that you need to forgive. Now pray and ask God to help you forgive this person once for all time, just as God, for Christ's sake, has forgiven you. Pray for each person one at a time in your heart, beginning with your very own self as I pray. Father God, there needs to be some healing on today. You said in your word that anything we ask in faith, believing, if you are a real Christian, now I ain't talking about church folks now. That's a whole nother message about church folks. Because I could talk about them for a while. But I'm talking about a real Christian, a born-again believer who's placed their trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. You are forgiven. Now allow me to tell you why I'm so excited about that, about the fact that you've been forgiven. First is the question of who needs forgiveness. Anybody know the answer? Everybody. We all need forgiveness. Me, you, mama, grandma, pastor, Pope Francis, we all need forgiveness. All have sinned. Bible don't say y'all have sinned. It said all have sinned. Each and every one of us have come short of the glory of God. And we all need forgiveness. Now I need to talk about the difference between the fact of sin and the acts of sin. We commit many acts, and the reason we commit the acts is because of the fact. And the fact of sin means that I was born a sinner. I was conceived in iniquity, and since my mother conceived, I was born a sinner. It's like a little baby rattlesnake. Does he have to do anything to be a rattlesnake or become poisonous? Just be born. So in order to become a sinner, we didn't do nothing. It wasn't about what we did. It was about how we were born. See, Adam and Eve started the whole mess when they messed up and Daddy Adam got me in the sea. Oh, but I got some good news. Oh, Jesus Christ got me out. He came to redeem me and set me free. So now that we have talked about the fact of sin, I don't know about you, but I'm glad I've been forgiven for that fact. And that it still remains forgiveness for the acts. 1 John 1:9 said, if we confess our sin, not only will he forgive our sin, but he is faithful and just to cleanse us. Does somebody need cleansing today? Oh, come on now. You quit playing with me. I know I'm not the only one whose mind needs cleansing. I know I'm not the only one that has some thoughts. I know I'm not the only one who did some deeds. We all need it. I don't care how they like to say it, baptized, blood washed, and Holy Ghost filled. Yeah, you still sin. Yes, you do. You know, it's in our nature. And we need forgiveness. So I want you to know that forgiveness is available. Now that we've established that we all need it, let's talk about what it is. Forgiveness is the act of excusing or pardoning another in spite of their shortcomings, errors, or wrongdoing. As a theological term, forgiveness refers to God's pardon for the sins of mankind. Christ prayed to God to forgive when he was on the cross, and he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. It was not a plea that willful sin be excused, but rather they didn't have any real understanding of what they were doing. They thought they knew, but they really didn't know. They thought they were doing the right thing. Let me see if I can explain that to you. This is one of those God-ordained times when the wrong thing was the right thing. Let me tell you what I'm talking about. In other words, what they did was the right thing in the sense of it had to be done. He had to die. He had to go to Calvary. But it was the wrong thing because they were doing it for the wrong reasons. They weren't doing it because God said they thought they were doing it. Oh, I got an analogy for you. That person that hurt you so bad, that thing that happened to you, oh, it was the wrong thing, but it was for the right reason. Then you come out better. Don't you feel better? Aren't you a little stronger? Aren't you drawn in your faith increase? Can you draw a little closer unto the Lord because it happened to you? Oh, I thank you, Lord. Oh, I'm like David. I even thank you for my trials, because if I didn't have them, I wouldn't know you like I know you now. Oh, God, I wouldn't know how to trust you in the midnight. Oh, if I hadn't had a little rain, I wouldn't be able to appreciate the sunshine. All that they did to you. Think about all that hurt that you experienced. Oh, and it seemed like the wrong thing, but it had the right reasons. For the Bible says all things still do work together for the good of those who love the Lord and are the called according to his purposes. Hallelujah. To accept God's forgiveness includes the responsibility now to forgive others. But there's one person you need to forgive before you even go on to others. You need to forgive yourself. Yeah. Some of us messed up. Look, I have done some stuff so stupid that if I told you what it was, I hope you wouldn't believe me anyway. We are all short. So first of all, forgive yourself. Oh, what, that bag's too heavy? What that fan say? You don't need to check it at the curb. Don't be carrying around all that excess baggage. God don't care. Look, he said he'll throw it in the sea of forgiveness. Now it's man that gets out there with a pole trying to dig it up. So you just ignore him and go on because God says he has forgotten. Let me also clear up this myth about forgive and forget. That's not in the Bible, honey. The Bible don't say that, okay? What's supposed to happen is that you're supposed to be so completely free of that, you're supposed to let it go so that when they walk in the room, you don't feel a thing. Hey, come on, God. Just keep on stepping. Keep on walking. Let it go. Get over it. Get on with your life. Don't be like the CME member and stay out of church for 3 years. Right. Well, guess what? That preacher was a man before he became a preacher. Right. You know that? So talk to the Lord about it. And the Lord didn't send us to straighten out the preacher and straighten out the church. I don't know about you, but he's not my job. You know, I might be an elder in the church, but it ain't my job to run it. It ain't my job to straighten out stuff. It's my job to take it to the Lord in prayer. So first of all, forgive yourself. And then learn how to forgive others. Amen. Forgive everybody that has, is, and will try to ruin your life. Because trust me, there's a whole lot of people out there that don't like what they see. Right. Now, I don't care what you've done or what you've done. There's somebody that don't like you. They don't even know you, but they still don't like you. Amen. Accept it and get over it. Yep. And move on with your life. Yes, even that one, that special one. Forgive everyone, everything, every hurt, every pain. Forgive. Amen. You are forgiven to forgive. Yes. You've been forgiven to forgive. Forgiving others is the key to living in the liberty, the freeing forgiveness of Christ. The judgments of God are based on his perfect knowledge, not just on the actions, but rather on the motive. He knows what you did and why you did it. Nobody, you cannot hide from God. He's always with us, ever present with us. So get over it, whatever you did, forgive yourself, and then whatever others have done, forgive them. Forgiveness does not mean that there's an absence of justice, but rather justice and mercy acting in perfect harmony. If it wasn't for justice, whoo, hallelujah, wouldn't be no need for mercy. So God is a just God. Yeah, Christ had to go to Calvary because God can't be anybody but God. And he said sin is wrong and said it had to be punished. Thank God for Jesus, somebody, that went to Calvary and paid it all for me. I'm mighty glad about that. Adam and Eve started out. They committed the first sin and passed the sin nature on to my ancestors and me. He forgave them and gave them another chance. I'm not going to be long before you today. The day is long spent. I just want somebody to know that you've been forgiven to forgive. I just want somebody to understand deep down in your soul that you are really forgiven. You don't believe me? I got some examples. Moses was a murderer with a speech impediment. God forgave him and used him to lead God's people out of Egypt. Yes, he did. David was an adulterer, a liar, and a murderer. He forgave him and called him a man after his own heart. After he'd been forgiven. You've been forgiven. Rahab was a prostitute, if you want to go there. And he forgave her and let her be in the family lineage. Matthew was a hated tax collector and a thief. And he forgave him and made him a disciple. Paul was a persecutor, a serial killer of sorts, killing Christians. But he forgave him and made him a powerful preacher. Oh, hallelujah. And he forgave him and gave him the keys to the kingdom. I don't know about you, but I'm glad about it. I don't know. You might not think that's good news, but I know it is. I don't care what you say. Word of God says you're forgiven. You're forgiven. You're forgiven. You're forgiven. Do you understand? I want somebody to get this down in this home. You're forgiven. him a chance. Because I would have been out of chances a long time ago. He's a God. He's a God of another chance. And whatever you've done, whatever happened to you, you've got another chance. And don't forget about me, Miss Goody Two Shoes I was. Church girl, born in the South, raised in the church, amen. Didn't smoke, dip, drink, or chew, and didn't hang out with those who do. The worst kind of self-righteous mess you ever wanted to see, because I didn't know Jesus. Well, I was in the church all right. But one day somebody told me that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. One day somebody told me Jesus went to Calvary to pay for a wretch like me. And I was glad about it. Hallelujah. I said, now either something wrong with this man or I'm a sinner. Even though I've been in the church all my life. So that doesn't have much to do with anything. But if you love Christ, if you turn your life over, you're forgiven. I'm forgiven. You're forgiven. Even on a bad day. You're forgiven. Jesus was having a bad day one time. One Friday. It was a bad day. One Friday. And they crucified him and hung him on an old rugged cross, stretched him out. Oh, but a bad day became a good day. And God became Good Friday. Hallelujah, because he died for me. Hallelujah, because he died for you. Hallelujah, because he set us free. Hallelujah. I told you I'm on assignment today. And as I close, I want you to think about something. I thank God I'm forgiven. I want to read, turn to Ephesians 4, 31 and 32. Put out those smartphones and Bibles, and if you don't have the Bible on that, shame on you. If you say you're a Christian, and you ain't got no free Bible. Now what's up with that? Ephesians 4, yeah, free app. Free app. You ain't got no excuse no more when you're on the bar and at the fire station and at the bus and in the doctor's office. You don't have no excuse. I want to read from my old raggedy New Living Translation from Ephesians 4, verses 31 and 32. And I'm reading from the New Living, but I want you to follow along with me. And then I'm going to ask you to pray and to do something with me. Ephesians 4, verses 31, 32 in the Living Translation. Say, stop being mean. Stop being mean. Bad-tempered and angry. Quarreling with harsh words and dislike of others should have no place in your lives. Instead, be kind to each other, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, forgiving one another, forgiving one another, forgiving one another, just as God has forgiven you because you belong to Christ. I want you to be silent for a moment. I want you to be in prayer just for a moment. And I would like if you have a pencil and you turn over and do it on the back of your program, on a notepad or somewhere. But if you don't, at least do it in your heart. Think of three people you need to forgive. Yourself and two others. Think of three people you need to forgive. Now review in your mind why you need to forgive them. Go with me. Close your eyes, if that helps. And actually picture yourself first, and then the two others that you need to forgive. Now pray and ask God to help you forgive this person once for all time, just as God, for Christ's sake, has forgiven you. Pray for each person one at a time in your heart, beginning with your very own self as I pray. Father God, there needs to be some healing on today. You said in your word that anything we ask in faith, believing that it's already done. And we're believing for healing on today. Healing of unforgiveness. Healing of resentment, healing of offense, God. Just wash it away. God, let them feel the blood of Jesus Christ washing it all away. Now accept God's forgiveness as well as your own forgiveness and tell at least two people that they are forgiven and that you have forgiven. Go ahead, tell at least two people at your table that they're forgiven. And tell them you have forgiven. Finally, let's give God a praise for having the word of unforgiveness lifted off us today. Hallelujah. Somebody give God some praise.
Hallelujah. Isn't it wonderful to be forgiven?
Amen.
The Bible says, whom the Son sets free is free indeed. So when you think about that, if we're forgiven, the moment that God comes into your life, He saves us. He calls us out of darkness into the marvelous light. And then we're supposed to be lights to shine into this dark world to draw other people to God.
Amen.
So I don't know about you, but with God living in me, who is God? The Bible says God is love.
Yes.
God is love. So God lives inside of us. Yes. We have a choice as to whether we're going to let God direct our lives or whether we're going to let our flesh take control. Yes. So we have to battle that flesh every day. Every day you wake up, it's like, Lord, I want to walk in the Spirit. Use me, Lord, to spread your love. The Bible says love is patient. That means love is long-suffering. That's what it really is. When you say patience, it kind of pretties it up. But patience is long-suffering. That means if someone's offending you over and over again, no matter how many times it happens, no matter how hurt you are, you can't put walls up to protect yourself. You gotta trust God to protect you. You gotta show that love in spite of. And kindness, love, it overcomes evil. Overcome evil with kindness. I have a poem I'd like to share with you. It says, when Jesus looks upon my life, what picture does he see? Does he see his own reflection, or does he just see me? Does he see his likeness, the product of his hand, or just another Christian who never took a stand? Does he see a child of God, a child that he made free, living life to honor him, or does he just see me? What about the other folks I meet along the way? Do I show them Jesus to brighten up their day? When someone looks into my eyes, can they truly see that calm and gentle peace of God that dwells inside of me? When I reach out and shake a hand, is he right there in my grip? Can they feel that strength from God that steadies me when I slip? When folks are in my presence, do they know his Spirit's there? Can they see that he's the one who guides me everywhere? When other people think of me, what is on their mind? Do they think of Jesus Christ, so gentle and so kind? I try to be like Jesus every single day, spreading love and kindness all along my way. I'm afraid that I have failed. I could not pass the test. Deep inside my heart, I know I haven't done my best. I've had to fight my flesh since the day that I was born. It's always causing trouble and being such a thorn. That's why his Spirit dwells in me. He's helping me to learn in every situation where I need to turn. He knew I'd never pass the test. That's why he took my place. He gave his life to save my soul. He suffered my disgrace. Now I try to be like him. I must present him well, so other folks will want his gift and turn their backs on hell. Other folks should see the joy that Christ has given me. They should want to have it too, especially since it's free. They should begin to ask me, what is it they must do? Just how it is they go about in getting Jesus too. Then I get to tell them, this wondrous gift is free. It only takes a humble heart and a prayer on bended knee. Someday, when I'm face to face with the Lord who made me free, will he see his own reflection, or will he just see me? I thought that poem really summed it up. We have love inside of us. We have the gospel, and it's free. There's a dark, dark world out there, so many hurting people, and it's our job. God is relying on us. He uses people to bless other people. So it's our job to go out there. I don't want to live in the land of Gogi. Does anybody know what Gogi is, the land of Gogi? The graveyard of good intentions. You know, so often we say, okay, I know that person's over there hurting. I'm just going to go talk to them, pray with them, tell them about Jesus, tell them Jesus loves you. But I'm tired. I need to go home. I need to rest. But you know, tomorrow's not promised. So we need to take advantage of each and every day that God gives us and go spread the good news. The love that's on the inside of us, it's not just for us. He didn't save us just for ourselves, otherwise he could take us to heaven right now. Amen. He left us here for a reason. Amen. So we have an obligation. We each have an assignment. We each have an assignment that God puts in us. Like I said earlier, it's not for one person to run around ragged and do it all themselves. But if you do a little bit, if you do a little bit, you do a little bit, all those little bits, how much could we accomplish with all those little bits?
Amen.
So I challenge all of you to think about it. Everywhere you go, spread the love of Jesus. I thank you, thank you, thank you for making this another successful Gathering of the Hens Fellowship. Happy Mother's Day. I thank my husband for allowing me to do this. I thank each and every one of you, because seriously, if it wasn't for you, this wouldn't happen. I was actually thinking about canceling it. Some of you know I had a rough year so far with my health. I wasn't able to get out and see singers and dancers. So as a matter of fact, normally we reserve the room. The day we leave, we reserve the room for the next year. We didn't do it last year. So I'm laying on my back. It keeps coming closer and closer and closer. And I'm always vying with another church for this room. But this year, they called and they said, you know what? It's starting to fill up. Regina, are you interested in having a room? Wow, that's God. He said, have it. He said, have it. But I didn't have a speaker, I didn't have a singer, I didn't have a dancer. Then I get a call from Eddie. Oh, I heard the most magnificent singer, Regina. If you don't have a singer, you should think about using her. I was like, tell her to come. Then Rosalyn called her. You know what, Regina? You having your Mother's Day celebration? My daughter has an awesome voice. I think she'd bless you. Tell her to come. You know, and Sheila from Unity, bringing Unity and Graceful here. Tony going out to the extravaganza in Vallejo and bringing Sister Sakari here. Every single act someone brought to me. That is nothing but God. So, when God says do something, listen. Listen and just do your part. Even in the church. We know in the church it's like, what, 20% do all the work and 80% are just pew members? That ain't right. Okay, so even think about that, because actually, who gives you your abilities? God. Who woke you up this morning? Who put the breath of life in you? You need to breathe that out into this dark world. Breathe life into other people. Share the love of Jesus. Thank you.